there's been some things going on in another town. I'm on the other side of the country as we've been talking about healthcare. And healthcare is changing. We just don't know how it's changing right now, but it's changing. But when we started planning this expo a number of months ago, I reached out to an old friend of mine, Dan Munro, and said, Dan, I know that you are one of the top voices in Quora on healthcare and healthcare issues. You are speaking nationally and internationally on this particular topic. And more importantly, you're not cutting any of us any slack. So you've got a new book called Casino Healthcare. And Dan is going to help to set the stage on who the players are at the table. Dan?
So thank you very much. There's a clicker here, but first and foremost, I have to sort of give you a disclaimer that anything that I say is not an opinion that represents Forbes or any other publication that I've written for. It's really here under the auspices of Casino Healthcare, which released last year, but as a reference, the book itself is probably more topical now than it was actually when I released it. I was hoping when I released it that it would be more of a part of the dialogue going into the election cycle, but as it turns out, that didn't quite happen. But now it's in a lot of ways even more topical, and I'll help frame that, which is really my job today, is to help frame the discussion around innovation, because I'm not an innovator, at least not at this point in my life. I'm sort of on my third career. The first one was in software, and I did heads down software development for about 4 years for IBM, and then moved into the sales and marketing side of software, and then early stage ventures, two of which were in healthcare. And literally 10 years ago today, we were the ASU startup of the year for the small infrastructure software company that we incubated. But anyway, since then I've been doing a lot of writing about healthcare, and I wanted to give you, first and foremost, is the congratulations on the Arizona Bioscience Week, which is coming up in October. That's a great accomplishment, and it's great to be a part of that. So this is a cartoon that appeared as a result of Donald Trump's attempt at repeal and replace. And I thought it was kind of cute in part because it's the childproof safety cap, and of course a man with small hands has a little trouble opening that. And that's kind of where we are today. And as it turns out, I happened to be in Washington, D.C. last week. And what we saw was effectively a Greek tragedy in three acts that spanned literally 18 days from March 6th to the 24th. The American Healthcare Act was announced, was discussed, was debated, was changed, was altered, and then was withdrawn as far as a vote. And I think it helps to frame an understanding of the legislation for the road ahead, both in terms of innovation and in terms of where we can expect the future to unfold. So one of my favorite authors is Michael Crichton, and of course he's famous for Jurassic Park. But I'm a big fan of one of his quotes, which is, if you don't know history, then you don't know anything. You're like a leaf that doesn't know that it's part of a tree. So with that framing, I want to do two slides really quickly on sort of the legislative history of healthcare in the United States, because it helps to understand where we are in that roadmap. And I'm not going to go into reading all of the individual healthcare reform acts, but it goes back to 1921. Social Security in 1935, Health, Education, and Welfare, HEW, was founded in 1939, is now HHS. 1942 was what's known as the Emergency Price Control Act. And while it doesn't reference healthcare directly, I put that in red because we'll come back to that, and I need you to put a kind of a pin in that as an understanding for some of the road ahead. And then we had Medicaid version 1.0 in 1960, of course, Medicare in 1965. And I put Medicaid in small letters because that has now become a more significant component in a lot of ways to health care in this country than even Medicare. And then in 1986 was in Tala and Cobra. Won't go into the details of those other than to say here's where we are today. And the current history really started in about 1993 with the Health Security Act. And I put a big E on that for effort. And that will be known by some people as Hillary Care. And that's really where we started naming legislation after the people that authored it. And so Hillary Care was really the Health Security Act. And then 2010, the Affordable Care Act, what I'm calling version 1.0, in part as a testament to my software background, we love versioning. And that's how we sort of increment software is with versions. So the Affordable Care Act, really version 1.0, was in 2010. Since then, we've had the Patient Care Act, which again got another E for effort. The Patient Freedom Act in 2017, which got another E for effort. And then the American Healthcare Act, which I put as a small E. It's hard to really call that a big E for effort when it spanned the short term that it did. So when you add all those together and you layer the legislation on top of it, on top of each other, this is what you wind up with. In the sense of a car, as an analogy, and of course, Obamacare or the Affordable Care Act is at the tail end, and we slapped a bumper sticker on the back of that saying, I love Obamacare. But this car, in the sense of driving, is unwieldy, it's inefficient, it's impossible to maintain, and it's expensive. And so that's kind of where we are today. And the other aspect that we've created through those layered pieces of legislation is a huge political piñata. And that's represented here, in part because it becomes a football between competing agendas and competing points of view. So we have a car that is kind of an amalgam, and then we also have a big political piñata. And that sets the stage for the complexity that we have today, and that's where I go back to another author, which is Michael Lewis. And he's done a whole bunch of movies and books, but it was about a year ago that he was promoting one of his latest books, which is Flash Boys. And he was on 60 Minutes, and he gave this quote, if it wasn't complicated, it wouldn't be allowed to happen. If it's so complicated that you can't understand it, then you can't question it. And that's kind of what we have today, and that was kind of the impetus for me to write Casino Healthcare, in the sense of helping understand the complexity of our healthcare system. The reality is that it's not as much complex as it is opaque. It's hard to see in the sense of the whole system. And that's where another slide was also an impetus to writing the book. And this one was actually presented at a healthcare conference in Washington, D.C. about 2 years ago. And it was delivered to the conference by a well-known cardiac thoracic surgeon. And as soon as she put this slide up, I took a picture, because I've seen the meme before, but it was the event and it was the person who put it up on the presentation that made me realize that this is what would help in the sense of a book to help navigate the understanding of the system. And so that's really what prompted Casino Healthcare. I think there's enough copies here today for everybody who wishes one, and I'll be around for the balance of the day, certainly to sign them, and I'm happy to do that. So as a fan of the movies, how many people here have seen Martian? So you know the slide, right? It's Matt Damon. Let's do the math. And so let's do the math as it relates to the Affordable Care Act. So we're on day 2561. We don't use Sol, in part because we're not on Mars, but we use day 2561. It's been before the Supreme Court now three times. It's had one win, one loss. And the House v. Price issue is still pending. So one for three with one pending. And the risk corridor payments were cut about 90%. And there have been, in the course of the 7 years, it just celebrated its seventh year last week, in the course of the 7 years, it's had 50 challenge bills that were vetoed by President Obama. And it's had three House bills that didn't even get to a vote. So seriously challenged, but what did it accomplish? And here's the math behind what it actually accomplished. This is the one thing that it did in the sense of its historical view relative to insurance coverage. It reduced the number of uninsured from what was approximately 18% down to less than 9%. And that's a phenomenal number in the sense of providing health care insurance and coverage. The other thing it did, which doesn't get a lot of attention but is an important variable as it relates to pricing of health care, is uncompensated care. It reduced the amount of uncompensated care that gets billed through the hospital system as reflected by this chart. So when there's insurance coverage, uncompensated care goes down, and that has a corresponding effect on price as well. The two things it didn't do was it didn't change the national health care expenditure. And that trajectory is represented in this chart through 2025. And the data that I'm using here is by CMS. And they've been at this since the early 70s. And so they're pretty accurate in the sense of generating these numbers. The important metric here is that we've gone from $3 to $4 trillion. We'll go from $3 to $4 trillion in about 6 years. The jump from $4 to $5 trillion will happen in about 4 years. So as you can see, the cost is becoming a huge economic part of the challenge on the road ahead. The other piece that it didn't solve was how that translates to cost for the average American family of four that gets their insurance through their employer. And this number comes from a company called Milliman, which is an actuarial firm, and they've been doing this for a long period of time. And as you can see, the number for last year was $25,000, almost $26,000 for a family of four, annual cost with PPO coverage. Now, in fairness, that's both the employer cost and the employee cost, but it's likely to eclipse $27,000 this year when the number is released in May. And I track that every year, and I also write about it. So how does that all play into the comparative narrative for American healthcare as it relates to other countries? And this is the one chart that I try and get out into the realm as much as I possibly can, in part because every other industrialized country fares better in terms of per capita spending and in terms of health outcomes. Now, we can debate a lot about what's on that y-axis relative to life expectancy. And there's a lot of room for debate in the life expectancy category. What's not for debate is what's on the x-axis, which is health expenditure per capita. And today, for 2017, that number is $11,100 per person that we spend as a country on health care. So it's in effect, it's unsustainable. And that's really the message behind this. But the other message behind this is that you have to look at these other countries in the sense of understanding what it is about those other countries that's so vastly different than what we do here in the U.S. What are they doing differently and better, perhaps, that we can look to and say that's something that we should think about? And the one category that comes up time and time again is this one. And I make a big, big point of this in the book, in part because it's a big distinction between universal health coverage and single payer. There's a tendency to simply lump the two together, and they don't necessarily belong there. You can do single payer in a universal health coverage system, but you can also do multi-payer. And in fact, all of these countries have different payment mechanisms for their healthcare system. Some are single payer and government run, which is the UK, as an example. Others are single payer, but not government run, which is more like Canada. And others still, like Germany, are universal health coverage, but multi-payer, where they actually have commercial payers in much the same way that we do. And this is the big single difference between all these other countries in the United States. So what do? The best way to categorize what we have is selective health coverage. And it's divided into these categories based on employment, Medicare, Medicaid, uninsured. Now we have this new category called Obamacare, individual insurance off the exchanges, and then miscellaneous insured. And when you lump all of those together, that's 323 million Americans, but it's divided up in a way that we have supported and built a system that's selective or tiered coverage. And why do we do that? In order to support tiered pricing. And it's the tiered pricing that becomes the challenge in the sense of maximizing revenue and profits through a system that other countries have elected not to do. And the employer has the asterisk because I don't know if you remember that placeholder that I talked about on the legislative side. The employer-sponsored insurance, ESI, is the result of that legislation that happened in 1942, and it's actually an accident of history, in part because the legislation made no reference to health care. The whole purpose of the legislation was simply to freeze wages during the war, during the Second World War. When they froze wages, they recognized a need to sort of leave the door open for benefits as a way for employers to compete for shortages in talent. And so that opened the door for employer-sponsored insurance. And we've been living with that ever since, and we're the only industrialized country that uses employment as a mechanism to deliver health insurance. The effect of that, which goes unnoticed for a large part of the population, is the tax consequence of that, which now amounts to the second largest entitlement for the country as a whole, only behind Medicare. And when I say entitlement, it means that it's a tax exclusion at the federal, state, and local level that allows this engine to continue, which is to say that that revenue isn't seen or incoming to the federal, state, and local level. It's not a direct tax consequence as much as it's an indirect one, but the effect is about $600 billion a year that the government doesn't see in revenue, in part because of employer-sponsored insurance. So all of this sets the stage for what we have today in the sense of Obamacare, and this cartoon, I think, summarizes it well. Here we have, does he have health insurance being wheeled into the ER? And he is health insurance, is kind of where we are relative to trying to sort out what to do about insurance and coverage. And the EMT in this case is saying we're losing him. The public opinion relative to the Affordable Care Act is pretty well divided in the sense of understanding all of the moving parts and pieces to it. This is the most recent poll from the Kaiser Family Foundation, and it represents 49% basically approve and 44% disapprove of what's happening with Obamacare. This is another poll from the Monmouth University. What should Congress do with the Affordable Care Act? 58% of the population think we should keep it or keep it and improve, and 39% think that we should repeal and replace or simply repeal. So that brings us, that sets the stage for what we can expect on the road ahead relative to the next iteration in legislation. And I think we're probably through the 2017 political cycle in terms of what happened with the American Healthcare Act, in terms of seeing another, we may see another bill, we may see more tweaks, we'll certainly see a lot more activity out of HHS relative to making modifications and tweaks to the system overall. The next up on the political scale is really the cost-sharing reductions, which is that Supreme Court decision that's pending. And the next date for that is probably in May, potentially June, relative to HHS deciding whether or not to continue funding that. And if they do continue funding that, it means that the Obamacare exchanges and insurance that's available on the individual market will likely survive in a healthier way than what it's on trajectory to survive today. So that's kind of where 2018 is probably the next iteration of the midterm cycles, and it may be that as the result of the midterm elections, we begin to see the formulation of a better, bigger healthcare bill that has better potential politically. in all of this noise, it's kind of hard to get good signal. And this is where this year at HIMSS, I had a chance to attend, and there were two events that I think represent really strong signals for the road ahead. And the first one is on the left in the upper corner is Michael Levitt from Levitt Partners. And he was formerly governor of Utah and then also formerly Secretary of Health and Human Services. And his comment was that we're literally 25 years, if you go back to 1993 and Hillary Care, about 25 years into what amounts to a 40-year cycle of healthcare reform. And I would tend to agree with that. All things considered, based on what we've seen to date, we're in a big window of healthcare reform, and it's starting to accelerate because of the national healthcare expenditure. We simply can't afford to keep going at $11,000, $12,000, $13,000 a year per capita. What it's doing is sucking all of that money away from other budget items, not just for the government, but then also for individual companies as well. The other big signal was John Boehner, who had a chance to sit down at the end of the event and talk about his view. And I would tend to agree with what his assessment was, which was that he openly admitted and regrets today having even entered the word repeal into the lexicon, in part because there really is no repeal. Obamacare is not like prohibition. It's not something that you can simply unpin and say, there, we're done. There's too many pieces and parts to it, some of which are pieces and parts that we will absolutely keep and that this administration has already indicated support for. One of them is the age of 26 for staying on parents' plans, and the other is, of course, the pre-existing condition clause. Because at the end of the day, when it relates to insurance, I mean, we all have pre-existing conditions. And the article last week was a testament to this when it highlighted the study that said that 66% of all cancers are basically the result of random cell mutations that aren't genetically related and aren't the result of environment. And so when you look at that, it's a case of, wow, that's a huge study, and that's a huge implication as it relates to consumer health care and all of us on the road ahead for our individual health. So my view, and it's expressed in the book, and it's basically the function of the book is a full-throated argument for universal health coverage. How we pay for that is up for debate. I think single payer is one option. I think multi-payer is probably more of a cultural fit for us, but we desperately need to get to universal health coverage because that's the way the math works. The math benefits by having everybody in one pool. That's how you maximize the cost, or minimize the cost to each of us as individuals, is through universal health coverage. So that's a function of the book. And this is supported in general by a lot of people in the Capitol, and in particular Senator Bill Cassidy, who came out with this quote: "There's widespread recognition that Congress has created the right for every American to have health care. If you want to be fiscally responsible, then coverage is better than no coverage." And so that's the road ahead in the sense of getting to universal health coverage. How we do that is the function of probably a 40-year cycle, and we're about 25 years into that. And then I like this quote in part because it summarizes and gives us a good guidance. It's often attributed to Winston Churchill, but it turns out it's a function of what's called Churchillian drift, which means there's no evidence he actually said it. It turns out that the evidence is actually this gentleman who was an Israeli politician. So we have to give the assignment its credit. But the reality is that Americans can always be counted on to do the right thing after they've tried everything else. And that's in a lot of ways exactly what we're trying today. So with that, I thank you very much and welcome the chance to have the panel come up, and we'll have a a further discussion on all of this relative to the road ahead.